Shall we introduce ourselves?
You may do that if you like. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Alex. What's your name?
My name, Ed.
Alex.
Okay, good.
I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. You were talking so brave and so sweet, giving me head on the unmade bed while the limousines wait in the street. Those were the reasons. That was New York. We were running for the money.
I would want to talk about, maybe particularly in relation to Chelsea Hotel number 2.
Okay.
In relation to representations of, because to me that's a very moving video, and yet it's full of this extraordinary sort of glamour of touch and of deeply artificial things, like objects, cheap, trashy, gorgeous things that are sort of standing in for love or for kind of tenderness, or but they're also very fleeting. So it's a very literal sort of representation of a passing love affair in some way. Mm-hmm. But it's also deeply, I guess, surreal. You know, it's an overused word, but insofar as these kind of combinations of things and juxtapositions, which are both very natural and very strange as well, and gorgeous, that these sort of pairings. I don't know, like there's something about love, artifice, relations, objects coming together, falling apart. Mm-hmm. I wonder if you could talk around that, I guess, a bit.
Well, I mean, I think that Leonard, I imagine like when Leonard was making the song and speaking about this like love that he had, you know, mm-hmm. there's like, whenever you lose something, immediately it becomes something else. You know, mm-hmm. it like, it's raised in this way that like, it has a new pedestal where, yeah. and that's like what become, you know, memory becomes fantasy like very quickly.
Sure.
Or horror or nightmares. It can go either way, but it becomes something skewed from what it is. And I think for the food items and the plastic things that I used in Chelsea Hotel, they all are in their own right proposing to be something other than what it is.
Yeah.
So like, the shampoos I was using, this like purple shampoo,
yes.
is called like, you know, like lavender mist or like, you know, like tropical breeze. It's like something really
exotic.
It's supposed
to evoke some sort of gorgeous reverie or something.
Right, right, but it's like 69 cents, you know what I mean? And
yeah,
so
yeah.
like, there's something about like the number 69 mm-hmm. being the price point of mm-hmm. the thing, which like gives you a certain kind of like fantasy. Mm-hmm. And then the idea that it's like cleansing, but also taking it to another place.
Yeah.
It's all of these things that like, in some ways, the loss of a love can do immediately.
But is that, I mean, without being sort of too cheap, although we can be cheap, it's fine, the kind of, like the Proustian reverie of something, I mean, there are really kind of crass, you know, peeling banana as a dick, as a, and then the kind of, you know, raspberries on the fingertips and things, they're all sort of almost hackneyed cliches of love, but there's something in your thing that is also affords some grotesquerie around that. Like everything is kind of, maybe it's also got sort of coatings of glue or latexy things or mud on it. And you know, these hands have been through a lot, you know.
Right.
So some sort of. So,
well, I wonder, I think when I was making that work, and with most of the work I've made since, you know, I never seem to like, or my hope is that you can just approach something that's deemed untouchable, say like Halloween mm-hmm. or you know, a banana. It's like, of course a banana is a dick, but mm-hmm. but can it be something else? And like, or yeah. does it have to be something else? Or is it like fine to just embrace that as a new language where like,
yes.
We know that it's become this other euphemism and we just yeah. use that as the truth. And so it's like, never is a banana not a dick.
Well, this is great. This is like the, I don't know whether this is true in a sort of American English colloquialisms, but definitely in British English, there's this kind of, like footballers when they're talking about, I don't know, a tackle on someone, they'll say, he literally took his legs away, you know. And what they don't mean is literally, they mean figuratively. Mm-hmm. But this suddenly sort of shift from literality into figuration and back again, where when someone says, I literally fell head over heels in love with them, you know. It's like this, it's kind of a gorgeous confusion, but it doesn't matter because we all know what you mean, you know, this kind of agreement. A consensus might be achieved around a kind of, almost like a dumb but kind of gorgeous slip, mm-hmm. you know, like a banana. We all agree that, you know, maybe there's a fluency now in a kind of sort of marvelously cheap symbolic order in some way.
So how does like one then approach that standard, or that, you know, how does one approach that new standard as, and then try to like unravel it or something? It's like if you portray someone like literally falling, you know, head over heels and say, okay, this is like what it is to be in love.
Yeah.
Then where do you go from there? Because we're left with like these new platforms.
Completely. I don't know, but there seems to be something that's playing itself out, and it's certainly something I feel is this kind of the coming true of everything in some way. And that sounds like overly profound, but I mean it in that way of like, it actually is happening, or the banana is a dick, and we can agree that. So then from that there is maybe the kind of the literalizing of things affords this kind of grubbiness as well. You know, it's mm-hmm. like touch, like the tangible. These things become extra real or something, or hyperreal, or sort of excessive in their appearance, mm-hmm. and therefore a bit grotesque, but also somehow kind of truthful in their, I don't know, either their erotic kind of aspect or their tangibility, their viscosity. There's something about the sandwich stuff, the ketchup, the glitter. All of these things are very, but then the incredibly sedate song. But there is still this, all of this stuff feels palpable in a way, you know?
Yeah.
Midweek. 50 times. The 20th century.
Little things I should have said and done.
Matthias was talking about how you were talking about like HD TV or like hyper quality TVs,
yeah, sure.
and how like that it's hard to look at television now because it's like realer than real, and
which
like
was weirdly cheapening as well.
You right, it, like it's like because I think
it's like a home movie,
right,
something.
Or it just looks like bad. Yeah, like there's something about the quality that's yeah. all of a sudden is reversed. And
yes.
I was, you know, in the sense that maybe the touch in Chelsea Hotel is like, it's basic. I mean, it's like the quality of it is just like a, you know, a phone camera.
Yeah, sure.
But maybe because of its like insistence, the touch can like move beyond the screen. New high quality.
New haptics or something, right?
But or new high quality, you know, or high definition televisions proposed to be actualizing some experience or making it truer, but it's not. It actually divorces you from that truth.
It's strange that, and I feel like that might be rooted in a feeling of fallibility within the tech, and almost a kind of empathetic way of feeling about technology.
Mm-hmm.
That actually, what we don't want is the technology to be, for its fidelity to be such that it sort of usurps our own mortal kind of clumsiness or something. So there's something. For me, I'm often throwing way too much lens flare at stuff, which obviously hasn't used a lens in any way.
I love a lens flare.
Yeah, I love a lens flare. But also dust motes or like ridiculous depth of field pushing and stuff like that, which is, these are clearly sort of, or at least originally, technical error in some way. You know, it's a problem of lenses that they do that when you get light on them. But they're also, it's a weirdly comforting thing. You know, it's to sort of retrieve some analog error or something, which I think weirdly it does afford some sort of understanding of it, and therefore a proximity to it, and maybe even an intimacy with a cultural product that is at least teasing you with its sort of muckiness or something, or its fallibility. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah, I was thinking of I was just thinking right now of the sun in my eyes and how there's, I'm having a lens flare. And thinking of your video, Happy Birthday, and how, like you said, your use of lens flares and these dust motes.
Motes. Yeah, it's a good word, yeah.
That's a nice word. Yeah. How like that is like a proposal for it to be real when it, clearly there's like nothing real within your world.
Yes. And
I was thinking about just like what that world is, like what the world of Happy Birthday is.
Yeah.
And I had two, so I had two questions for you.
Uh-huh.
One, when I was watching it, I was thinking of a movie like Terminator, where Terminator or Back to the Future plays with this idea of like new futures or, you know, imminent futures, and how someone has gone to the future and then left a message for the person.
Yes.
That, you know, a young person or a non-born person to discover in the future. And I imagine, is Happy Birthday some sort of message in a bottle for someone in the future?
Nice.
And secondly, in this video where the man hugs this person, to me that's like one of the most poignant parts. And I thought, who is that person, and what is that? And is that that moment where the two people meet?
In 6 weeks, 6 months to a year. In 6 months to a year, could be 6 months to a year. And this time next year, in a fortnight.
A bit like the moment when Bill Murray and Scarlett Johansson meet in Lost in Translation. And can you speak to both of those things?
Yeah, nice. I mean, I really like the message in a bottle thing because it, well, it sort of affords me the possibility of an opacity around the work for myself. Because that person that retrieves it in the future potentially is me. But then I also balk at the idea of ever fully understanding what the hell I've made. You know, I don't necessarily... I think I spent a long time trying to kind of hermetically understand every aspect of everything I'd made. And everything had its sort of right place, symbolically, at least for me. No one else would get it, but I knew, you know. Whereas I've sort of recently deeply enjoyed affording something, and I don't really know what, and I'm not certainly not trying to romanticize this in any way, but just allowing things in and movements and images that might arise. Not that it's my muse, but it just happens or whatever. And actually enjoying watching them now. Mm-hmm. Like I enjoy watching them because I don't get them. I don't get to have them. But it's interesting the idea that maybe that, you know, that there's some sort of futurity embedded in them. Around the promise of meaning, or the promise of resolution. I mean,
but also the promise of alienation.
Like. Sure, totally. I mean, but that's yeah. I mean, it's something around the hug, which comes back a few times, and the sort of horribly failing to touch hand on the back of the head, in sort of badly rendered hair.
Well, there's nothing worse than like hugging someone and the other person not hugging back.
Yeah. Or just doing like, the sort of three pats on the back and then slowly guiding you away.
Yeah, there's many ways to hug.
Well, there's nothing worse also than, I mean, actually, no, I'd prefer to be hugged vigorously by someone that I wasn't expecting to hug me like that.
Yes.
but the guy in this thing, for a long time, I had trouble having faces in videos, and I'd often have the back of a head as a sort of, as a deeply resistible thing, you know, that it, the back of a head that never turns, what a horrible sort of conundrum, you know, some sort of deep-rooted problem of never, you know, I couldn't think of anything more opaque in a way, nothing more horrible.
That's like the place of dreams. I mean, it puts you in the place of dreams.
Exactly. You know, that face that might turn and be one from nightmares.
Or your face.
Exactly. Or it's the face in, you know, that face from beside the diner in in that David Lynch film. The hell is that? Which one am I talking about? Mulholland Drive.
Yeah.
You know the thing behind the thing?
Yeah, horrifying.
Yeah, just that. But, you know, faces as a kind of sight of all things somehow. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And actually the CG stuff sort of answered that problem because I was filming real things, and this is a really long-winded answer. But I don't know who the thing is or the person is that he's hugging. I don't really know who he is. He's a surrogate, and certainly for me, but I'm not sure entirely just for me. There's, you know, if I were to really entertain something that's probably not true, he's a kind of, like some horrible, determined everyman, you know, but the everyman that's been determined by way too much kind of ideological pressure or sort of state managed whatever. I mean, he's a white guy who looks like that, you know. Yeah. He's a sort of like the most violent idealization of a male figure somehow, but also creeps up on you with his demand for your empathy in some way. So in answer, I don't know in either way what either of those things, but I really like the reading of these because of the kind of my vote is for incoherence, you know, mm-hmm. which I believe to be the only sort of, this is very different, but there's a wonderful Judith Butler thing about the only way to approach the other is to afford them their incoherence to you, that actually determining them, trying to make them cohere according to whatever schema you have, whatever presumptions, anything like that, is a violence. So affording them to be, and she doesn't mean incoherent like, you know, like an Edward Lear poem or something, but she means just allowing them, in all of their discretion, this kind of mess. And I, not that that's necessarily something one wants to extend to work, to cultural products, but there's a rehearsal of it that's possible there, is allowing this, you know, I mean, it's also the video loop is something that just keeps happening, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess, you know, the Chelsea Hotel is different insofar as it's a song as well, you know. So it has a kind of, it has a clear beginning and end. Yeah. Even though that sandwich never gets made and
And no one ever eats it, which is so
no
sad.
No, I know, right. Did you eat any of that stuff?
The banana.
You ate the banana.
Yeah, good. Obviously.
Yeah. The only uncontaminated thing. Yeah.
You got a way I never once heard you say. I need you. I don't need you. I need you. I don't need you. And all of them jiving around. I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. You were famous, your heart was a legend. You told me again you preferred handsome men.
Could you say something about the how that piece came into being through that Leonard Cohen song and through Leonard Cohen, right?
Yes, Leonard Cohen and his daughter Lorca Cohen, you know, were organizing a show in which they invited 13 artists to respond to one song from his album New Skin for the Old Ceremony. Mm. And so they had asked a bunch of people, and I was maybe fifth or sixth on the list, and no one had opted to so work good. With Chelsea Hotel.
I think scared of it. I would think, in some way.
I think maybe I was a little bit stupid at the time, and so I was like, sure, I'll take that one.
I know, it's clearly the right move. Yeah.
But maybe at the time I wasn't worried about how it held up in history, you know, or at the time I thought I could do it, and it was my first video that I ever made. And yeah, so I think they put together a program of that album, and yeah, this video just kind of came to be as some sort of weird experiment.
What did they say things back to you about it?
I think that they enjoyed it. You know, there was so many great artists in that program. Right. Christian Holstad was in it, and Tina Tyrell, and Brent Millspaugh, and Peter Coffin.
Yeah,
all great video and makers.
And what's happened to them as a body? This album videos?
The program screened, originally screened at the Hammer Museum and then at MoMA and then, you know, all about the world. And I don't think you can get all of the videos like as a package, and I wish you could.
One day.
But they, you know, they exist in broken parts in the world.
It's funny, actually, just talking earlier about, I suppose, artifice and potentially like ways to retrieve some sort of very mortal intimacy with work, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I was thinking about Leonard Cohen, actually, you know, like one of his, I mean, the reason he means something to me and I'm sure to, you know, why he means things, it's because there is some fundamental deep humanity in everything that he's done. And but to me, a lot of that is based in his kind of fundamentally, I keep saying mortal, which is too grand a word, but you know what I mean, like decrepitude in his voice, or the kind of ponderousness, the lack of a sort of honed voice,
right?
The musicianship, you know, everything is appeals to something. It's very necessary. It's very close and very real, you know.
I don't think he doesn't promise in his voice to be anything that he isn't.
No.
You
quite.
Know, he's just very
But it's not
straight.
The kind of now ubiquitous sort of trilling voice of whatever, you know, that's in every episode of The Voice or whatever.
Right. That's like about fantasy and denial. Yeah. And I think he's accepting of his ways, but his ways are flawed, or his ways are hopeful, or they're dread. And I think that that's what makes him human, you know. It was interesting for him to organize this program, you know, because it's also it speaks to his generosity, you know, in terms of being free to, you know, and open to artists interpreting his works and responding and mutating, you know, things that he's put into the world. You know, he allowed those songs, you know, to be found objects and to be manipulated, which, I mean, you can understand that, you know.
Of course. I feel like his fundamental, he's also a very generous creature with the songs, which I feel like is something that I feel like is in your work, is this, and something that you've definitely talked about before, is something around vulnerability, something around authenticity, both of which are kind of very, you know, they're tricky words, because it's hard to, particularly with like authentic, what's authentic, right, you know,
right?
Because I feel like I've often rehearsed the idea that we're never not performing or something, so therefore there is nothing, it's only surface, but that's not a problem, that's not a pejorative idea, but then again, I'm always trying to find a word that will substitute properly for that, you know, because what I really want, which is why I keep saying stupid words like mortal or fallible, or, you know, what I really want is that chafe of real and therefore kind of mutable and failing kind of experience. You know, there's this great...
Is that about touch?
Little bit, totally. But it's also about, you know, the reality of a body, or the reality of intimacies, or the reality of this world versus the world that I'm putting in the videos. The world in the videos is a horrible, purgatorial kind of looping nowhere.
I will. And you will. I will. I will. You will. He will. She will. It will. They will. We will. We will.
There's a great, very old now, Leo Bassani book called The Culture of Redemption. It was originally about literature and around Proust and Bataille and Joyce and things. But the argument fundamentally is one against the idea of culture as making up for the failure of experience. The culture shouldn't step in and pretend to compensate, to be more than experience. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Even though he adores Proust, there is this problem there, which is that it's too much. It's like, it's sort of trying potentially to compensate for Proust's lack of experience. And I feel like I want my work to be wholesale, not the thing itself. I don't want to pretend. I don't want people to suspend disbelief and go into my world. I want them to be constantly rejected by this thing. Allured, totally, and rehearse that point. Do you know what I mean?
I do. I mean, when I went into your work to see Happy Birthday, I mean, I was speaking to you about Brecht a little bit.
Yeah.
In terms of the alienation factor.
It's perfect, yeah.
But I think upon revisiting it, what I realized was that to experience it, or if to think, like to think about Happy Birthday, I was imagining like, what would it be if today was like the first day that I was in that world, which it is, or maybe it's the second day, but what if every time I saw this, I was experiencing it for the first time?
Sure.
What could I like take from it? And I thought it's definitely not meant to save you or to solve anything. It's a fragmented, you know, non-narrative that is full of reference. I mean, I you know, was thinking of George Orwell and Wizard of Oz and The Fight Club and, I don't know, corporate branding and you know, the Terminator, and was thinking it's an amalgamation of so many cultural references that sort of aim to speak to something about being human, but also what it means to be a human today or in the future or to come, and like what it means to kind of cope with the abundance of information.
And to be, and alone with that in some way.
Yeah, and maybe Happy Birthday for me, or what I walked away with, was that every day we get like a sort of truckload of new information. And so every day we're sort of reborn. But it's not to say that your work is proposing to save you from that. It's just giving it to you.
Mm.
And I think that that's really fresh.
Thanks, man. Yeah.
Keep track of each fallen rock. I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. That's all, I don't even think of you that often.